Hello students, looking at current affairs for 19th Feb, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 14. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, three Jaish men killed in Pulwama. So four army personnel, including an army officer and three Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorists, of which two are from Pakistan and one a local of Pulwama, were among the nine persons who were killed in an 18-hour gunfight in Pulwama's Pinglena area. So this is 4 days after the 40 CRPF jawans lost their lives in the suicide car bomb attack in Pulwama. So these three Jaish-e-Mohammed militants, they had weapons and ammunition. Four weapons and ammunition were recovered from the site. Four houses, including one in which the terrorists were holed up, caught fire and were damaged. So this was the first joint exercise of security agencies against Jaish-e-Mohammed, which is recruiting locals in Jammu and Kashmir now. The next is Quash Kulbhushan verdict. So this is regarding India taking the Kulbhushan Jadhav case to International Court of Justice, which is the UN court. So here India is arguing that Pakistan knowingly, willfully and brazenly flouted the Vienna Convention on Consular Access. So you should know everything about this. The underlying terms are important terms. So Kulbhushan Jadhav case, everything about him, about the International Court of Justice of UN and about the Vienna Convention. So we'll discuss about it in detail too. So India has attacked the farcical trial of Mr. Jadhav in Pakistan. So farcical, it's a farce, means it's only an outside facade, a show. So Mr. Jadhav, Kulbhushan Jadhav, has been found guilty of spying by a Pakistan military court and has been sentenced to death. So this was the sentence announced in 2017. India argues that Pakistan violated Vienna Convention on Consular Access because it did not give consular access to Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav. So the hearing also, it says the ICJ case hearing took place without former Pakistan Chief Justice Tasadduq Hussain Jilani. So he had taken it, so he was not part of the bench, but he would be coming in for further proceedings the next day. So the International Court of Justice is going to hear this matter. So the 2017, after the death sentence been announced, the International Court of Justice had intervened and had given provisional measures that said that Pakistan should not execute Mr. Jadhav until the full proceedings can take place. Means because the case has been heard at ICJ, means the death sentence cannot be put into effect. So that stay as such was provided by ICJ already, and now the hearing has started. Indian counsel for the case is Mr. Harish Salve, who is arguing for India. And India maintains that Pakistan violated the Vienna Convention. So Pakistan says that the Vienna Convention would not come into effect. It says that the 2008 bilateral agreement on consular relations between India and Pakistan would apply to this case. But India insists that it is the 1963 Vienna Convention on Consular Relations which should apply here. So if Vienna Convention applies, then ICJ has its jurisdiction too. So Mr. Harish Salve, arguing for India, has focused on the military court system in Pakistan too. He said that these courts are being increasingly used to try civilians. The military courts, but civilians have been tried in this case, and it's an opaque and secret proceeding which takes place. Many civilians, including possibly children, have been convicted in Pakistan's military court in the past couple of years. So these arguments have also been brought forth. The fact about Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav is that he was, Pakistan says that in March 2016, he was arrested in Balochistan in Pakistan. And they say that he is a spy of India and he was working in Pakistan in Balochistan region to create unrest in the country. So, but then India argues that there is no evidence which has been brought forth against Mr. Jadhav. Whatever we have heard are confessions, and these are doctored confessions over and over again. So confessions, there is high rate of confessions from civilians who have been found guilty by military courts. So these also raise questions about the adequacy of safeguards within the military court system and possibility of torture being used to extract confessions. So these are India's arguments at ICJ. So Indian counsel Mr. Harish Salve argues that the evidence suggests that the review and relief mechanism available to Mr. Jadhav and India is highly inadequate. So we'll see what further steps are taken, what happens for the developments at ICJ. This is the entire detail regarding Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav. So it was in March 2016, Pakistan claimed arrest of Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav in Balochistan on charges of espionage, spying. Later, Pakistan summoned Indian envoy, and then Pakistan released a video of confession of Kulbhushan Jadhav and accused him of sabotage. trying to create, you know, deliberately creating trouble in Balochistan. Then in December, there was a statement given of lack of proof against Jadhav, but then Pakistan said that no, that is not true. So a statement came forth, but then Pakistan retracted it. And in 2016, Pakistan military court finally gave its death sentence to Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav. But then India says that he was not arrested from Balochistan. He was kidnapped from Iran. He was stationed at Iran at Chabahar Port. So he's a former Navy officer. So India says that he's a former naval officer. He was working. He had quit the Navy and was having his own business. And he was working in Iran at Chabahar Port. So here you can see. So the Pakistan military court have been established under in January 2015. You can see these courts, they were to be automatically disbanded after 2 years. So by 2017, they should have been disbanded, but that has not taken place. Just days after Jadhav's conviction on 22nd March, Pakistan Senate passed an amendment to grant them extension for another 2 years. So it was under this Pakistan military court that Kulbhushan Jadhav has been sentenced. And this is regarding Vienna Convention. There is Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations and one on Consular Relations. 1963. So it talks about how consular relations should be established between states by mutual consent, and diplomatic relations established implies consent to establish consular relations too. So the consulate interaction can take place that way. So this, and this is regarding ICJ, International Court of Justice. So this is the principal judicial organ of the United Nations. It was established in 1945. Its seat is at The Hague in Netherlands, and court's role is to settle in accordance with international law legal disputes submitted to it by the states. So when states, member states of UN, submit these legal disputes to it, it gives its advisory opinion on legal questions referred to it by United Nations organs and settles disputes. Composition of ICJ is 15 judges, and these judges are elected for a term of 9 years. So this is their official language at the court is English and French. And there's another court to International Criminal Court, ICC. So there's a difference between ICJ and ICC. ICJ is a UN organ established in 1945-46, while ICC is independent body, not an organ of United Nations, and was established in 2002. So UN can also refer matters to ICC. Both are headquartered in The Hague, Netherlands. So jurisdiction of ICJ is UN member states, while ICC individuals can approach it. So it looks into, as the name says, International Criminal Court, it looks into criminal prosecution of individuals. And here ICJ is regarding two nations, contentions between parties or advisory opinion sought. So this is it. Generally at ICC, it's genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, crimes of aggression are put forth. And these may be regarding sovereignty, boundary disputes, maritime disputes, human rights, treaty violations, etc. So funding, UN agencies, UN funded, while ICC, it is, voluntary contributions come from governments here. The voluntary contributions from UN also come from. Then next is Rafael case, petition seeks perjury action. So this is regarding the Rafael case. So a PIL petition has been filed in the Supreme Court, which is seeking to initiate perjury proceedings against government officials. So what is perjury, if you understand? So perjury basically means lying under oath. So means willfully acting, of swearing a false oath. So you are taking oath when you come before judicial proceedings, you take an oath that you would speak the truth. But then when an individual willfully makes false statement during this judicial proceeding after having taken an oath to speak the truth, it is called perjury. So now a petition has been filed to initiate perjury proceedings against government officials who submitted false misleading information in sealed cover notes regarding Rafael deal, which misled the court. So in December, on December 14, 2018, the Supreme Court bench headed by Chief Justice of India Ranjan Gogoi had ruled that there was no ground to judicially review the 36 Rafael aircraft deal. So it had seen the sealed documents which had been submitted by the government, and post judgment information came in public domain that showed that the court was not in full grasp of facts before it decided in favor of the bona fide of the aircraft deal. So judgment had spoken of the CAG report as having been submitted by as such the parliament and has been verified by the public accounts committee too. But the fact is that CAG report was not ready then, it was not submitted. So this false information being submitted to the Supreme Court is being questioned and perjury proceedings are sought to be initiated. So it says the judgment was based on more than one untruth submitted by the government. But the government, you can see on the next day itself, on 15 December 2018, it came before the Supreme Court calling for correction because the statements given in the Supreme Court ruling were interpreted wrong is what the government says. We'll see that also. So this is the entire timeline you can see of the petition, PL petition filed in March 2018 on the Rafael deal. So this is 36 Rafael fighter jets brought through intergovernmental agreement from France, the Dassault company. So in September, Supreme Court agreed to hear this PIL petition, which was seeking a stay on the deal. And in October, Supreme Court agreed that fresh PIL petitions, which are asking the center to file details in sealed cover, will also be accepted. Center actually provided the details in sealed cover in October. And you can see in November, Supreme Court looked into those details. The center placed the price details also in sealed cover. Supreme Court gave its order on December 14, in which it said that there was no need for a CBI inquiry into the irregularities in the Rafael deal. So you can see what the petitioner wanted and what the court's viewpoint was. So petitioners alleged that decision making in the Rafael deal was flawed, but Supreme Court said there is no occasion to really doubt the process. Then the allegation was that there was difference in price compared to the original deal, the medium multi-role combat aircraft deal, if you can recollect. We'll see that too, entire timeline has been given. So the earlier deal which was there for Rafael fighter jets, there was better. So there was difference in price compared to the original deal. Here now the new deal had higher price. So the Supreme Court on this said that it's not the court's job to compare prices. And third allegation was that government was biased for Indian offset partner. So in the deal, an offset partner had to be selected, means the 36 fighter jets would be selected, and in this there would be an offset clause, means how much amount the government pays for buying these Rafael fighter jets, a percentage of it would be returning back to the country. So the means Rafael owner, that Rafael manufacturer Dassault, it will get the money for the Rafael jets which it is selling to India, but that money it should put in back into the country. So this offset clause which was there, so there should be an Indian offset partner through whom Dassault can invest in India. So that Indian offset partner selected, the petitioner said that government was biased because Reliance was selected as the Indian offset partner. But then court said that it is not within court's experience to step into it. So that was the Supreme Court's ruling in the matter actually. So the controversy erupted, you can see, because of the Supreme Court order which said that the pricing details of Rafael deal have been shared with CAG and report of CAG has been examined by Public Accounts Committee. While Congress claimed that the government misled the court regarding the Rafael deal scrutiny by CAG. The fact is that no CAG report was submitted to Public Accounts Committee. So no such report was there before Parliament because CAG report came much later. Recently it was in news. So this is there. So government actually clarified that this comment by Supreme Court came from a misinterpretation of a note submitted to it. So government said that is mentioned in the note that is looked into by a CAG meant that CAG will look into it. Supreme Court interpreted it as CAG has already looked into it. So of course it made a huge difference to the ruling too. This is the entire timeline you can see. So actual requirement was not of 36 fighter jets but 126 fighter jets, medium multi-role combat aircrafts. So for this you can see medium multi-role combat aircraft bidding process also got initiated. So here you can see it was in 2012 that Rafael actually became the winner with the lowest bid, and in 2014 Hindustan Aeronautics Limited and Dassault signed work share arrangement for agreement for 108 aircrafts. So under this 126 fighter jets, what was proposed was 18 would be brought from France in flyaway conditions and remaining 108 would be made in India. So Make in India in defense was a major part of this deal. So Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, the defense PSU, would be the partner with Dassault, which would be manufacturing these Rafael fighter jets in India. But then the deal did not go ahead because Dassault also refused to take responsibility for the fighter jets which Hall would be manufacturing. which would be manufactured in India. So the deal did not go ahead, and suddenly the government announced a new deal to acquire 36 fighter jets in flyaway condition. And the argument given was that India is in dire need of these aircraft, so that is why they are being purchased. But still, the demand requirement of 126 aircrafts would remain. And here there was a Make in India provision too, but here this is all 36 in flyaway conditions. So this is a new deal which was signed through an intergovernmental agreement between India and France. So announced through that. So this is under scrutiny now. And the petition filed, Supreme Court said no irregularities in this new deal. Then next is Supreme Court sets aside NGT order to reopen Sterlite plant. So this is regarding Thoothukudi in Tamil Nadu, the Sterlite copper plant here, which belongs to Vedanta Group. So this was shut down in April 2018 after Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board rejected its application for renewal of consent to operate. So consent to operate was not renewed, and the reason it was not renewed because the Sterlite copper plant of Vedanta did not comply with certain conditions laid down under Air Act and Water Act. So it was indulging in pollution. So that's why it was proposed to be shut down, but then the National Green Tribunal ordered reopening of the Sterlite copper plant. So now the case has went to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court has set aside the decision of National Green Tribunal, and it has given Vedanta, the parent company of Sterlite copper, the liberty to file a writ petition before the Madras High Court. The plant has remained shut since April 2018, and Supreme Court has now asked the case to go before Madras High Court. So this is the entire history of the Sterlite copper plant. Vedanta, it established its unit here in Thoothukudi, in that is earlier name is Tuticorin. So this resulted in protests because the plant would result in pollution in the region. So this is 1996 when the Sterlite copper smelting unit started functioning. In March 2013, Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Jayalalitha ordered plant to be closed after a gas leak. But NGT, you know, was also asked to investigate into these complaints. Then in 2015, it was the plant was reopened after a favorable report from NGT. NGT's committee, that is NIRI. So then after that, 2016, the company sought environment clearance to expand the plant. And then in 2018, plant was shut for maintenance because there were protests over these expansion plans. An expansion plan was not allowed. Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board rejected Sterlite's license for flouting pollution norms. And then there were protests in the region, and police opened fire on protesters, because of which 13 people died. Then Madras High Court stayed the expansion of the plant. Even the new Chief Minister, E. Palaniswamy of Tamil Nadu, he said that cops fired in self-defense, and he blamed the opposition for instigating the agitators. So plant has remained sealed since then, and NGT, though it ordered the plant to be reopened, but Supreme Court has set aside that order. It's the whole time. So protests were against the expansion of the plant. So this is the whole thing. You can see the NGT orders said that yes, electricity supply was actually cut through the Sterlite plant, but NGT ordered that electricity supply should be restored, and the Sterlite plant can have a website to air the grievances. People can air grievances there. And you know, Sterlite had offered to invest 100 crores on corporate social responsibility in nearby villages. So this proposal was accepted by NGT, but now the NGT order no longer rules. The Supreme Court has set aside that order. And this is the entire event leading to firing in Thoothukudi, or Thoothukudin in Tamil Nadu. Then next is Gehlot government gears up for social accountability bill. So this is regarding the Congress government in Rajasthan under Ashok Gehlot. So here, civil-like groups have been protesting for long and have been demanding a legislation on social accountability. So now steps have been taken. The Congress government, the cabinet at Rajasthan, has approved the Rajasthan Social Accountability Bill. So this bill now will be introduced in the legislature of Rajasthan. So this is a bill which will make officials accountable for timely delivery of public goods and services as citizen entitlements. So there will be a grievance redressal mechanism also in the bill. Provision would be there starting from village panchayat level. So also includes provisions for citizen charter, public hearing, social audit, information and facilitation centers, etc. So it is Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathan, that is MSMKSS, which is led by social activist and Magsaysay award winner Aruna Roy. So it has proposed a draft law and had submitted to the state government, and it is said that all the suggestions which were there, you know, all these provisions have been incorporated in this official draft social accountability bill of Rajasthan. So there had been a 100-day long Jawabdehi Yatra, which MKSS had undertaken through all the 33 districts of Rajasthan in 2015 during the previous BJP regime for demanding this legislation. But the demand as such was not, action was not initiated on it. Now under the new government, Congress government in Rajasthan, the social accountability bill has been approved by the cabinet to be introduced in the legislature. So here you can see this, the first time the government prepares a draft social accountability bill. So the key provisions of it are mentioned here, like rights under the act. So it's the delivery of public goods and services and entitlement, a right of the citizen as such. So the rights are mentioned here. Obligation comes on public authorities. Then there's a citizen charter. What is a citizen charter? We'll see. So every public authority is mandated to publish all goods and services rendered by them, including the budget provided to it by the financial and other resources. So this will be there. The charter will also provide the roles and responsibilities of every officer or employee of the public authority, and every financial transaction made by a department or body covered under the act should be routed through Janta information system or Sampark portal for citizens to be aware of all financial transactions. So this would be the level of transparency which is proposed. It is said all official communication correspondence have to be filed online and made available to the public. So this is conferring rights on the citizens. So then there will be registration of complaint provision for that too. Redressal mechanism would be there. Public hearing of grievances would take place. The government shall be responsible to take follow-up action on the findings of the social audit which would be conducted. What is social audit? We'll see that too. There are penalties provisions as such in the act too. In the bill, presently it's a bill. So what is the citizens charter? You should understand it was pioneered by UK government in 1991. So it aims to establish measurable and accountable public services. So public services should be measurable and accountable is the objective. Later UK has replaced the citizens charter by service first. So services first was initiated in 1991, and it incorporated at least 200 national citizens charters covering all major areas of public services. So this is actually a UK initiative which has been imbibed by other countries all across the world, including India. So the key principles of Citizens Charter you can see. So the Citizens Charter movement of 1991 had six principles under it. One is quality, emphasis on choice, wherever possible, standards, that what standard should be expected as such, and how to act if the standards are not met, value for money, accountability of individuals as well as the organization, and transparency regarding the entire transactions, rules, procedures, etc. So these were the original six principles of Citizen Charter movement of UK. Later the services first of UK had nine principles. So these are also listed out here, which were an extension of these, like set standards, be open, provide full information, encourage access, treat all fairly, etc. And this is social audit. So what do you understand by the term social audit? The concept originated in 1940s when academician Theodore Krebs called on companies to acknowledge their responsibilities to citizens. So private sector companies, they function, but there is their social responsibility aspect to it too. So this was in 1960s, 70s that a fresh wave of interest in social and ethical accounting, auditing and reporting initiated. And because of this interest, now this concept of stakeholders emerged and social audit emerged. So, and it has traveled from private sector to even the public sector, because even in public sector, we are seeing democratic governance trends emerging. So public sector also has this social audit concept now. So what is social audit is described here. You can see it is a way of measuring, understanding, reporting, and ultimately improving an organization's social and ethical performance. So we have an economic audit conducted. This is a social audit. It helps to narrow gap between vision and reality, between efficiency and effectiveness. So it values the voice of stakeholders. All stakeholders, marginalized, poor groups also get voices through social audit. So it enhances local governance, particularly strengthens accountability and transparency in local bodies. So what the key difference between development audit and social audit is that social audit focuses on neglected issues of social impact. Development Outlet has a broader focus on environment issues, economic issues, etc., efficiency of the project. But social audit focuses on neglected issues, the social impact aspects, which are generally neglected, which are not thought of beforehand. So that is looked into. So it brings in transparency, accountability, gives voice to people. So that is it. Then next is, after Pune Varsity backs out, Bhopal to host History Congress. So it was Savitribai Phule Pune University which was going to host the 79th Indian History Congress, but then the university backed out, because of which Congress government in Madhya Pradesh came fourth, and Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh, the Barkatullah University, is now going to host the Indian History Congress. The reason for backing out, it is said, was financial reason. So the local host apparently gave this reason. So this is actually unprecedented, because Indian History Congress has been held every year since it was initiated. It was only during Quit India Movement in 1942 and during the wars in 1962 and 71 that the Indian History Congress was not held. So thousands of delegates, including prominent historians, participate in the Indian History Congress, which will be happening this year too in Bhopal at Barkatullah University. So this is the entire detail given. The image is not clear. Then next is DRDO scouts for R&D partners. So this is regarding Defense Research and Development Organization. It is looking for potential partners to co-develop an engine for its planned advanced medium combat aircraft. So it's looking for partners. So there are future technologies which it is working on apart from advanced medium combat aircraft. Other five technologies which it is looking out for collaboration is these military technologies like unmanned combat aerial vehicles, unmanned aerial vehicles, materials, sensors, avionics, and artificial intelligence. So the steps are being taken here to have partners. So DRDO chairman G. Satish Reddy has given this statement on the matter. He's also the DRDO chairman, is also the secretary to Defense Department of Defense R&D. So this is there. So the government is attracting individuals, private sector to the defense sector. You can see there is this Dare to Dream challenge which has been initiated, and it is said it has received 1,000 responses so far from individuals and startups. The last date for filing response here is also 28 Feb 2019. So this is a Dare to Dream DRDO innovation contest. So this is to promote individuals and startups for innovation in defense and aerospace. So awards for individuals and startups are provided here. Eligibility is anyone, a citizen above 18 years of age, a citizen of India, and a startup has to be controlled by Indians and recognized by Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, which has also been renamed now, DIPP, to include internal trade, if you remember. Then next is, no need for probe into Mirage crash. So this is regarding the recent Mirage trainer aircraft crash which took place, in which two pilots died in Bengaluru. So actually a petition has been filed in the Supreme Court on a judicial inquiry into the crash, but the Chief Justice of India has ruled out any investigation into the matter. So the CGI says that, do you know, the advocate who filed the petition is asked, do you know what generation fighter is Mirage? On which the advocate had no answer. The Supreme Court Chief Justice of India actually told him that it is Mirage is of 3 or 3.5 fighter generation fighter, and other countries use 5th or 6th generation fighters. So this Mirage fighter has been procured from France, and it's a deal decades ago, which, and still the trainer aircraft is being tested. So the accident which has happened, the Chief Justice says that, what do you expect? It is bound to happen. It was an accident. An accident is an accident, and there's no question of a judicial inquiry. So this is the viewpoint of the Supreme Court on the matter. So this is regarding Mirage. As you can see. So Indian Air Force procured 51 Mirage 2000 fighters from France, and fighters started entering service in 1985. Presently, they are undergoing a comprehensive upgrade. So two aircrafts were lost in crash earlier too. The first two Mirages were upgraded in France by Dassault Aviation, and rest have been upgraded by Hindustan Aeronautics Limited in India. The aircraft that crashed was a trainer one and was undergoing customer acceptance tests after an upgrade, and it crashed. So this is there. The two pilots as such died, Indian Air Force pilots. Then next is emergency declared by President Trump. So we have already seen about emergency, which has been declared by US President Donald Trump so that he can build his wall along the Mexico border. So there have been emergencies declared earlier too. So there it is said, of the 59 emergencies declared since 1976, National Emergencies Act was passed, 32 are still active. So here you can see active emergencies in the form of sanctions. So the former presidents are shown here, President Carter, Reagan, Clinton, Bush, Obama, and Trump. So the number of emergencies which they had declared are also shown. The maximum have been under Bill Clinton, then George W. Bush. So what are these emergencies which are currently active? One is regarding blocking Iranian government property, that is in effect since 1979. Then national emergency by reason of terrorist attack, active since September 2001. Then blocking property of certain persons and prohibiting the export of goods to Syria, that has been active since 2004. Then this is regarding suspending entry of persons contributing to the situation in Venezuela, active since 2015. So presently it is US President Trump who wants to build the border wall, and emergency powers have been used by him to undertake this construction project so that he can get the fund for it. Then next is Facebook cannot be allowed to behave like a digital gangster. So this is British Parliamentary Committee which has prepared its report, in which it refers to Facebook as a digital gangster. It says Facebook failed to fight the spread of fake news and violated data privacy. So Facebook co-founder and chief Mark Zuckerberg was asked to appear before the Parliamentary Committee of Britain, but he refused or turned down three requests to appear. So this is there, and Facebook in this report is now being accused as trying to hide the extent of Russian interference in foreign elections. So in the report calls it a digital gangster, calls it the world's largest social media platform, which is undergoing, which is conducting unethical activities. So the committee has urged that a compulsory code of ethics for all tech companies should be there, which should be overseen by an independent UK regulator. It also says that Facebook should be obliged to take down sources of harmful content on from its platform. Also, the Parliamentary Committee of UK recommends that the government should launch an independent investigation into past elections. The UK elections of 2017, even the UK referendum, Brexit referendum of 2016, the Scottish referendum of 2014, to explore what actually happened with regard to foreign influence. So whether these elections were having foreign influence or not, this needs to be investigated, is also what the committee recommends. So committee had earlier also found that Facebook's engineers had flagged potentially malicious Russian activity as early as in 2014, long before this whole issue became public, but steps have not been taken by Facebook is evident. And Facebook officials were hiding facts from the committee. So that is why it is called a digital gangster and trying to hide details. It says that they gave incomplete, disingenuous, and at times misleading answers to our questions, the Facebook officials. So here you can see. Then next is RBI to transfer 28,000 crore interim surplus to government. So the board of RBI has decided to transfer an interim surplus. So dividend is transferred for every year, but then this is interim surplus which will be transferred of 28,000 crore rupees to the government. So this is the second consecutive year that the RBI is transferring interim surplus to the government. Otherwise, at the end of the financial year, you can see RBI transfers the surplus. So, in 2017-18, last year, RBI transferred rupees 10,000 crore as interim surplus. So, later it transferred the remaining amount, that is 40,000 crore. So, it's total 50,000 crore for that period, which was transferred by the central bank as the final dividend. So, the accounting year, you should know one important thing is that for RBI, accounting year is not from April to March, but from July to June. So for this time also, it is said RBI has transferred 28,000 crore as interim surplus. So remaining 40,000 crore which was transferred was also during this financial year only. So total, because it happened in June. So if it happens in June at the end of the RBI financial year, means the present financial year 2018-19 has begun. So 40,000 crore plus 28,000 crore right now means within this financial year, 68,000 crores has been provided to by the RBI to the government as dividend. So this is there. So what happens is that the audit of balance sheet happens by RBI. It is done twice a year, and this would be done later also. So in interim surplus is calculated and passed on by the RBI. So the government, we have seen recently how it has been putting pressure on central bank to transfer more funds from the contingency reserves, and now a dividend as such has been passed as an interim measure. On the even economic capital framework, we have seen RBI board has formed a body, a panel headed by former RBI governor Bimal Jalan, who would be reviewing the economic capital framework of the bank, that how much should it keep with itself, you know. So here you have the entire detail regarding the money which has been passed on. You can see, so the income of RBI is shown, the net surplus which it had, and the surplus which has been transferred. So that surplus is transferred, but since the last 2 years, interim surplus has been transferred. So earlier, for the previous year, it was 10,000 crore rupees, and later 40,000, so total 50,000 was transferred. And now for this year also, 28,000 has been passed already as an interim surplus. Remaining would be at the end of the auditing year of RBI, that is by the end of June. So this is important that RBI follows July to June accounting. So this, you can see, is regarding the surplus being transferred over the years. It had gone down, the dividend paid had gone down in 2016-17 because of the demonetization exercise. So the cost was incurred by RBI in this, the huge cost incurred resulted in surplus falling in this year. And this is regarding the economic capital framework panel, which has been established to suggest adequate levels of risk provisioning that RBI needs to maintain so that remaining amount can be transferred to the government. Government argues that RBI does not need to have such huge reserves. So this panel will determine whether RBI is holding provisions, reserves and buffers in surplus or in deficit of required levels. So this is the panel headed by Bimal Jalan, the former RBI governor. Next is cement makers happy as MFN status to Pakistan withdrawn. So cement manufacturers are heaving a sigh of relief now because India has withdrawn the MFN status, most favored nation status, from Pakistan, and has also slapped a 200% duty on imports from Pakistan. So this is after the Pulwama terror attack, and a major item which is imported from Pakistan is cement. Though this cement is of very low quality, but then it has a price advantage of almost 100 rupees a bag for 50 kg. So this was imported in the country, and now with this duty, import duty being imposed, cement import would reduce and it will benefit the cement manufacturers in the country. So this is the entire detail regarding the MFN status. We have already discussed about this in detail when it was revoked. So it is actually a non-discriminatory trade as such. It is a mandatory norm under WTO, World Trade Organization, that every country should accord this MFN status to every other country. Means if we are giving any concessions to any country, that concession should be given to all other countries also who are members of WTO. So no country cannot be, countries cannot be discriminated. That's what it says. A country cannot discriminate between its trade partners. So most favored nation actually means equality. It does not mean that this nation is most favored. It means if MFN was there for Pakistan, did not mean we are most favoring Pakistan, but we are providing equal treatment to Pakistan as any other country with whom we trade who are WTO members. So this was there, but now this MFN status has been revoked for Pakistan, and Pakistan on its side had never granted MFN status to India. While India granted MFN status because it is mandated under WTO. WTO was formed in 1995 and India granted MFN status to Pakistan in 1996. So it's non-discriminatory market access basically. So now MFN status removed, India can impose custom duties on goods coming from Pakistan. So bilateral trade between India and Pakistan is not very high. You can see it is India, its exports to Pakistan are high compared to imports from Pakistan. So we import very less, rather we export more to Pakistan. So you can see over the years, this is the figure given. And there's a major commodities of trade between India and Pakistan shown, like cement, sugar, and so on. Then next is Japan approves stem cell trial to treat spinal cord injuries. So this is regarding Japanese researchers. Now they are going to carry out an unprecedented trial using human induced pluripotent stem cells. What are these? We will see. That is iPS cells. So these will be used to treat spinal cord injuries. So the Japanese government has given approval for this trial. So it's Japan's Keio University which is going to undertake this trial, the team from here. So they are, these induced pluripotent stem cells are basically cells which are created by stimulating mature, already specialized cells. So they are taken back to their juvenile state. So it's like cloning without the need of an embryo. So an embryo, stem cells are required. Stem cells, you should understand, are cells which are not differentiated. They are undifferentiated cells, so they can be made into any type of cell which is required in the body, like a blood cell or a muscle cell or even a neuron, etc. But then stem cell is an undifferentiated cell. Now it has totipotency, means it is totally having the potency to be converted into any type of cells. So pluripotency is pleural potency. So this pluripotent stem cells are induced, human induced. So they can be made into any type of cells. Like for spinal cord injury, they can be converted into cells for this purpose. So this is a trial which will take place now. So the team has already there is another team. The team actually will transplant 2 million induced pluripotent stem cells into the spines of the patients who will be monitored for a year. So presently, focus will be on 4 patients who have suffered injuries just few days beforehand. And they would be undertaking, this trial would be undertaken through them, because this is an unprecedented, world's first such clinical trial. Already it has been seen that researchers in Kyoto, it was in news in November 2018, that they had transplanted 2.4 million induced pluripotent cells into the brain of a patient to cure Parkinson's disease. So such news have come forth. Even we have seen the Chinese researcher who has claimed that he has used stem cells for curing or for preventing AIDS as such. So such genetic engineering has already been used, but this is another grand scale trial which would be undertaken. It would be a human trial which would be initiated now for treating spinal cord injuries. Earlier trial is on Parkinson's disease. You should know about Parkinson's disease too. It is a chronic degenerative neurological disorder that affects the body's motor system. The body is functioning, the limbs, etc. So it causes shaking and other difficulties in movement. So here we have all the details. First of all, you should know the types of cells in the body. So there are two basic classes of cells in animals: somatic cells and germ cells. So somatic cells are the cells which we understand. Every part of the body has cells, like blood cells are different, skin cells are different, muscle cells are different. So these are the somatic cells. They have already differentiated and they are part of the body. So that is there. And germ cells. Germ cells are cells of the reproduction, like the ovary and the sperms. So these are germ cells. Then the third type is the stem cell, which are nothing. Like they are undifferentiated. So stem cells can also, you can understand. So they are when a child or when a zygote develops, when fertilization takes place, reproduction takes place, a single cell which is formed, that replicates itself and forms into a larger body and body of cells, and then the differentiation begins and different types of cells are formed. So that stage cells are called stem cells. So hierarchy of stem cells is there: totipotency, totally potent, pluripotency, and then you can see then they are differentiated and they can become different types of cells, like blood stem cells or other stem cells can become muscle cells, nerve cells, or part of bone tissue, etc. What are iPS cells? Induced pluripotent stem cells is understood here. You can see, so cells are reprogrammed, means adult somatic cells undergo a process through which they can become pluripotent stem cells. So they are taken back to the basic, like that. So other than having somatic cells to be procured from an embryo, they can, the somatic cells can be converted into or reprogrammed into stem cells. So those are called induced pluripotent stem cells. So there are somatic cells actually in the human body too, because still development takes place. So there are somatic cells, somatic stem cells too. So they are present here, you can see, in the body, in brain, skeletal muscles, in bone marrow. So it's basically in the blood vessels, teeth, liver, and bone marrow, where we have somatic stem cells present. So the difference between embryonic and adult stem cells is also given. Embryonic stem cells are totipotent. They can differentiate into any type of cell. And adult stem cells are pluripotent. They can differentiate into some types of cells. So this is there. So totipotent embryonic stem cells can be harvested from embryos. So that is highly unethical, means an embryo which can develop into a human as such can, will be used for harvesting or for getting embryonic stem cells. So that became very controversial. So now adult stem cells can be used, and even somatic induced pluripotent stomatic stem cells can be used too. So that possibility is also there. So here high ethical controversy is there. This is less moral and legal controversy. And one other thing is that embryonic stem cells, they may cause immune rejection, while adult stem cells, since they are from the same patient, the patient's own cells can be used, they are less likely to cause immune rejection and less likely to form tumors also. And this is regarding Parkinson's disease. So it results in tremors of the hand. It's curved characteristic, which is seen, unbalanced shuffling gait. So Parkinson's disease is a neurological disorder. So this, you can see neurons, which are nerve cells. So normal neurons, when the transmission takes place, there is this dopamine, which is present here, chemical present here between two neurons, how the impulse transfer takes place. But in case of Parkinson's, these Parkinson's affected neurons have less dopamine. So that affects and the body, and it's the Parkinson's disorder when which is develops, which results in movement disorders. So this is regarding Parkinson's disease. So in brain, you have the nerve cells, which have this terminal branch, and at the terminal branch, dopamine chemical is present, which passes on the signal, the impulse, nerve impulse further. So here, because of dopamine, there is weak signaling, and that affects the neurological functioning and causes motor disorder as such. So these are the symptoms of Parkinson's disease. And the last news is lack of cleaning in brain cells causes Alzheimer's. So this is a study which has been undertaken, which shows that a weakened cleaning system of the brain cells in animals and humans is the central reason for developing of Alzheimer's disease. So there is a cleaning system of the brain cells which is nearly removed, which is there, which is called mitophagy. So this mitophagy is when this mitophagy becomes weak, it results in Alzheimer's. And this researchers have found that if mitophagy is improved, then the symptoms of Alzheimer's were nearly removed in animals. So now this research would be undertaken on humans as such too. So clinical trial on humans will start in near future. So basically, there is this defective mitochondria which gets accumulated in the brain cells, and this accumulation can be really dangerous. So if there is a cleaning system, mitophagy, which is present, if it is weakened, then it results in Alzheimer's. And if the cleaning process is strengthened, then Alzheimer's symptoms almost disappear. So here you can see regarding Alzheimer's too. So it's a disease of the nerves where a person has a deterioration in his memory, thinking and reasoning. So it's in the brain. Here you can see there is this dying neuron with tangles and plaque which develops. So there are healthy neurons and dying neurons, mitochondria, which is present here. So these need to be removed. So mitophagy is the process. So selective breakdown of dysfunctional or damaged mitochondria. So mitochondria, which is called the powerhouse of the cell. So every cell has mitochondria where energy generation takes place, and there are lysosomes which take in these unwanted stuff, vacuoles and lysosomes. So mitochondria which are dysfunctional or damaged have to be degraded too. So these mitochondria in mitophagy process gets tagged for degradation in lysosome or vacuole. And because of this, accumulation of the damaged or dysfunctional mitochondria does not take place. So this is regarding mitochondria too. It's called the powerhouse of the cell. It is responsible for conversion of nutrients into energy yielding molecules, ATP, adenosine triphosphate. So this is the fuel for cell activity. So it functions, the function of mitochondria is aerobic respiration. So it's, that's why it's called the powerhouse of the cell. And these are the steps in aerobic respiration, glycolysis, Krebs cycle, etc. And electron transport chain. So that is it. These are the news items. Thank you.